Do we have anybody getting the invitation?
Jim,
how are you?
Okay, how are you?
Good. I'm glad to see somebody.
Yeah, you've done this before, right? So you know.
Well, we've done Hangout. I'm trying to record this to YouTube, and we haven't done that successfully. So, all right, all sorts of people are showing up. Omar, Steven.
Hello. How are you? Can you hear me?
Yeah. I ask a question. Where did you end up? Was it the email I sent that?
It was the email.
Okay.
Yeah, this most recent one was how we just got here.
Okay, so that's what I'll... let me see if I can get that to Abby. I got an email from Christian saying he's running late. No, not that. Let's see. There's David. All right, great. There's Hannah. Awesome.
Hello, I didn't get any email. I just got this with the link.
Okay. I'm learning how this all works. And that might be Abby?
Yes, it is.
Awesome. All right, great. Well, thank you, everyone. I apologize for the hiccup getting us started. Steven, if you would get us rolling, and any of you other guys just try to wave at me one finger or two fingers if you want to get in on a current point. You can do that while Steven's talking, and then we'll kick it back, and I'll try to keep a cue here, and we'll see what kind of feedback we can get. Turn it over to Steven.
Cool. All right. Thanks, guys. So I get the impression that Will wanted me to be direct and kind of efficient, so I'll just start it off. All right. So the main comment that I would start out with is that at different times on the paper, there seem to be kind of two theoretical mechanisms at work, and I was interested in how you could use kind of what you've got here to tease out those two mechanisms. Right, so one mechanism is kind of reassurance, so the government cracks down, and then that reassures some pro-government local. And then the second mechanism is just kind of fear or shut your mouth, as in the government cracks down, and then that causes people to respond to survey questionnaires perhaps in an insincere way. Right, so I was thinking about different options that you had for how you could use the evidence that you've got and assess those two mechanisms. Right, and so one option would be to use what you know about the actual events to assess the two mechanisms. So I went and looked at the Auckland stuff for Zimbabwe, and most of the events are pretty strongly linked to the shut your mouth mechanism. So there are two kind of most frequently occurring events. One is a human rights forum being formed, which I don't actually know why that would have any effect on anything. But the next most modal event is that some government supporter commits a horrible crime against another person. So it's usually like some ZANU supporter rapes someone. So I don't really know why that would have any effect on reassuring the local population, but I can imagine that having a pretty strong, like, shut your mouth effect. So some of the other events are maybe more plausibly linked to the reassurance mechanism, like the government systematically burns down certain people's houses, but that would also be linked to kind of the fear mechanism. So that one, I guess, at best is both. But anyway, so option one, can you use what you know about the events to assess the two mechanisms? All right, and then option two was, can you use some of the answers to the other questions that you've got to distinguish the two mechanisms? So the question asked in the manipulation check seems most appropriate here. So I think I forget the exact wording, but it was something like, do you think violence will increase in the future? And a positive finding there pretty strongly in my mind supports the shut your mouth mechanism as opposed to the reassurance mechanism. And same with like the trust in the police and freedom of speech questions as well. So like people are getting raped and murdered and somehow that's increasing my trust in the police. That to me says this is just people responding to questions in an insincere way. And then option three was, can you use analysis of the decaying effects of violence to maybe say something about the mechanisms? So by decaying effects, I mean we know that there's an effect of violence 5 days out, 7 days out, 10 days out, 25, 30. Can you say something about the rate at which that effect decays? And if it decays quickly, then maybe it's the shut your mouth mechanism. If it doesn't, then maybe it's the reassurance mechanism. At least from the regressions in the paper, this is hard to tell because there weren't regressions for the different time lags with controls. So I think the only ones with controls are the 10-day regressions. So we couldn't compare the effects 7, 10, 25, 30. Zach, Will, is that kind of about how long you wanted and how?
It's wide open.
All right, great. So that was kind of my starting things, the relationship between the theory and the empirics and particular mechanisms.
Okay. Omar.
Okay. Thank you very much for the comments, Stephen. So regarding the mechanisms, which is probably the most complicated part of the paper, I think. So we've been struggling with this quite a bit because we came up with this identification strategy that we think allows to isolate credibly the causal effect of exposure to these violent events on these measures of trust that we have. But the results are quite counterintuitive, right? I mean, we find that exposure leads to greater support for institutions. And so we've been trying to disentangle the mechanisms by using the information that is provided in the survey items. And I do believe that, I mean, I think that we cannot really claim that there is an increase in support to the state that is not related to the fear mechanism. Initially, we thought that there was some reassurance story, but you're right. Most of these events are about political repression and trying to, you know, achieve electoral success. However, we've been trying to run some tests, especially using non-responses, as we show in the paper, or the questions on let's say, political expression or freedom of expression, and we do not find significant association between exposure to violence and, I mean, in other words, we find positive association between exposure to violence and freedom of expression. This could suffer from the same problem, right? Like people are just reporting higher levels of trust in the government and higher levels of political freedom of political expression because they are just intimidated by the events. Based on this, on the items on the survey questions, I don't think we can do much more. We tried looking at non-responses, questions on freedom of expression, And also whether there was some systematic change over time in these responses and in the characteristics of the people that were interviewed. And we did not really find anything that make us think that people are afraid. However, as I said, this could be just systematic bias, right? Like people are just afraid of speaking out their minds, and unfortunately, we are not able to see any indication of this in the analysis. One thing that I thought could be useful is, for example, to try to talk to the actual enumerators in Zimbabwe and see, you know, more from the fieldwork, how this looks like, how they behave, what's the you know, the actual situation during the interviews. I'm afraid that this is probably the most complicated part of the paper, and it's hard to me to buy the result of you know, violence or political repression leads to higher trust in the government, especially in the case of Zimbabwe, because all the stories are about how the government tries to you know, to manipulate elections and repress people freedoms. So you suggested two alternatives. The one trying to dig more into the specifics of the events. I think that we should definitely do that, and in addition to do more, to dig more into the specifics of the fieldwork. Regarding the information that it's available in the Afrobarometer, I think there is not much more. I wish we could find at least, or we had found some indication that this is a story of fear. It's not what we find. Although, to be honest, I agree that it's deep inside of myself. I feel that there is a systematic bias in these responses. Like the people are just afraid of saying what they really think. But this is not what the analysis is showing. So thanks very much for the comments. And now, I'll just get some feedback, I guess, from okay. you. Or should I just...
I'm ready to jump in, but I want to make sure that others weren't trying to get in and I was missing them. Has anybody got put up a one or a two that I missed?
Add me to a one later.
Okay.
Yeah, I can.
Abby, you're?
Sure.
Okay. So I want to follow up on the, you know, as Stevens phrased it, the shut your mouth versus reassurance issue. And so... you said you don't buy the trust in government, and I'm pretty confident that you have two distinct processes that produce. And so, I think you've got a biased response, right? I assume you think that preference falsification is going on, but I don't think that's so much a problem for you if. Conceptually, you think about it differently than you're currently thinking about it. It seems to me that the Mugabe regime is very interested in generating preference falsification. That's, in fact, precisely what it wants to accomplish. And while there are going to be people who support the regime, of course, and there are going to be people who don't support the regime but know that they need to keep their mouths shut. And so even when you ask them questions such as, do you need to keep your mouth shut, I would think that the presence of government-sponsored violence, particularly given, you know, what I know about the groups that typically create that violence, I would expect it to be very effective and lead people to lie brazenly that, absolutely, I have no, there's perfect freedom to speak my mind. I would think my vote is definitely private, even though I'm lying, you know, in other words, I would think that Mugabe regime is sending out, you know, lifting the, sending the signal to the boys and the war veterans, as they're called, that go on out there and beat up on some people, and that that's, you in fact have evidence that that's a very effective repressive strategy. And so I'm curious, do you see it at all like that?
So the way I read the, I mean, my interpretation of this finding is that that okay. So I think we don't want to frame the paper as a paper saying that we find that exposure to political repression events increases trust in the government or in state institutions. I think that you're right in the sense that this might not be our findings might not be that problematic in the sense that even if there is some if these are not truthful responses, it's something that's I mean, it's a strong finding, right? It's saying that people, regardless of whether there is some self-censorship or not, people are reporting higher levels of trust, more political freedom, even if they if this is not true, right? So, if you look at the plot where we have the timing of proximity to the time to the election day, it's interesting that the effect is stronger. In fact, the plot is wrong because it's not plotting the marginal effect, but just the coefficient from,
is it, from the, this is figure two or
this is figure let me see.
Figure five.
Figure five. Yeah, so the effect is stronger as we get closer to the election. And in this case, we are only taking the 2005 parliamentary election in Zimbabwe. Because it overlapped with the timing of the survey. But it's interesting that the effect gets stronger. Like, people report higher levels of trust in the president as they get close to the elections if they were exposed to some violent events perpetrated by the state. So they do not say that they are afraid of the state or that they have to shut their mouth, but I think that the key is whether this actually translates into support for the president in the elections. I think that's probably what is interesting, regardless of whether they are afraid of not. We are observing that this could be that violence could be strategically used by Mugabe and actually have some results in the way the voters make their choices.
I agree, and I would encourage you to phrase it, just abandon the trust in government as a concept that you can measure effectively and instead make the point you're making right there. Because that's really, to me, this is a very interesting, I think it's, you know, it's one of those things, like, why didn't I ever think of this? A very cool idea you guys came up with. And but I think your framing will, at least through me, way off, and you'll see when I send you my comments. And I, if it didn't throw Christian off, that'll surprise the heck out of me. But David, you had a two-finger?
Yeah, I think it's in the same vein, which is just that whenever trust in government or trust in any political officials are discussed in this paper, it should be emphasized that it's about what respondents report, and it shouldn't be presented in a way that could be misinterpreted as being synonymous with actual sincere trust in government, and that's just a, you know, take, and there are places in the paper where it's careful in that regard, and there are other places, including in the abstract, where it's not careful. And I just think you need to be careful throughout. And as Will was saying, really emphasize the point and kind of lean into the point about it in fact being this sort of instrumental, insincere reporting trust because it's you sort of feel like you need to because you're cowed into it as being the likely mechanism or perhaps the predominant mechanism that's operative here.
Okay. Christian, Omar, did you want to respond?
No. I totally agree. Like framing, it's been like a big issue in this paper, and we are. I think the direction that we are heading to is moving away from this argument of, you know, people trust more the government because they were exposed to violence perpetrated by the state, and just claim. I mean, we cannot really tell whether that's true. We know that they report, you know, these higher levels in trust, and it could be because of fear. And even if that's the case, you know, it's interesting that it's actually probably it's working for the government. So yeah, that's that.
So the cue is Christian, Abby, and Hanna on one finger.
Sorry for being late. And if anyone has kind of addressed these comments before, I apologize for repeating them. I like the general endeavor, and similar to Will, it's kind of like, oh damn, that would have been smart to do. But in line with that, it seemed like you're kind of moving away from some of the stuff that I was going to have problems with. So I'll reemphasize some and maybe highlight some other stuff. I was kind of like. Initially, I was curious as to what was the interviewee's perception of who was conducting the survey, but kind of like David's kind of remark eliminates that concern of mine, right? And then Chris Anderson had a piece a couple of years back about awareness, citizens' awareness of human rights, to kind of showed that there was like very little awareness people had of what was around them, and so I found this proximity thing useful. Or interesting. I had some pieces on like how approaching or moving away from an election influenced state repression, so I was reading it kind of in like that light, and spent some time in Zimbabwe as well, and so was very interested in it. Let me go back to, I think trust might matter, but I don't think how you've operationalized the mechanism will get you there. And I say it this way, I'm more likely to trust government, but that's conditional upon the relative amount of contention. It's, I think, just state repression on its own wouldn't give you that. I think it's state repression relative to the behavioral challenge that is present at the time. And if the government repression seems to be responding to and containing, then I think that would lead to trust. By itself, repression I don't think would do it. By itself, I don't think riots would do it. If you're asking about government trust, then I think it's this relative issue. If repression is believed to be the precipitating mechanism that is prompting the dissent, okay, obviously that would go in a different direction. So while I think the pre-post violence survey insight was brilliant, at the same time, I'm worried about what's the sequence in this location, right? So if the last thing that happened was something that we believe, you know, is kind of in a series that kind of was prompting us to believe the governments were ineffective or they were leading to our troubles, not resolving them, then I got lost as to kind of where in the sequence you were kind of cutting it. And maybe this is where kind of some event-based stuff could help inform you with regards to what that sequence was by the time you get to the survey. And maybe that would help. Related to that, I was concerned about this issue of government accountability, right? So I was kind of like, do people associate what happened last week or the last time or what's going to happen with the president? Is the president actually responsible for what's going on? Because if they're not, then that leads you in like a different direction. So the principal agent stuff would suggest that people are not holding the governments necessarily accountable, right? And then Neil Mitchell's got some stuff on like how democratic leaders can avoid accountability all the time for stuff. And so you kind of jump some steps for me with regards to, okay, there's violence, and okay, the citizens are going to hold these people responsible and accountable. And actually, I think that's a really interesting question, right? Who do citizens, I mean, right, you know, we'd all like to have questions added into the Afrobarometer, right? But it's kind of like, who do citizens hold accountable for different types of actions? It might be in Zim that you hold the local police officer responsible for what happened in the area. Of course, then Mugabe's not responsible for that. He doesn't give a damn about my particular village. I mean, so there's some element of that that I think kind of gets obscured. So by the time you get to the table and kind of like, oh, we could look at how different leaders are being responded to, I'm kind of like, well, damn, how is Parliament responsible for this type of repressive event or activity? Now, if you're talking about, like, imposition of martial law, okay, fine, okay, I can see that. But are you talking, it seemed as if the violent events you were talking about, I think, would be more associated with agents than principals. So again, I apologize if anybody said that stuff before, and I have a whole bunch of stuff more on the paper, but I guess I'll go off of your answers to my questions or comments to see what I missed or did not contribute.
Well, just a quick point. I think those are great comments. We should definitely provide more information on a better description of the types of events that we are talking about here. So most of these events are perpetrated by state security forces, by the police, and are mainly against the opposition, against the MDC. I do not know whether people are, or to which extent people are aware of this, whether they attribute the responsibility of these events to the government or not. This is something that's why I want to talk to the enumerators, just to have a better sense of the violent situations for those specific dates. One thing that it's important to mention is that we do not observe the sequence of violent events. It seems that it didn't affect the systematic random sampling of the AfroBarometer based on the characteristics of the respondents that we have. There is some change in the education levels, but apart from that, ethnicity and age, gender, all these characteristics seem to follow the same random pattern.
That's my thing, though. It's like survey kicks in, and you look at the period immediately before that to determine if there's any different types of events. I mean, I didn't know that you had that kind of data, right? So it's just like presumably you'd have by the geographic locations the time series of events leading up to your particular survey.
Yeah. What we are doing effectively is just so there is one violent event, and we have as the control the people who were interviewed in that district within 10 days after within 10 days before the event. And as a treatment, people who were interviewed within 10 days after the event took place.
I got that, but you're not sure of the sequence that preceded that, right? So, like, you don't have a conflict history by that location.
That's right. We also tried, you know, like, excluding violence that took place, for example, 2 weeks before. I mean, like, we construct the treatment based on people who were exposed to violence 10 days before, after the 10 days before the interview, and the control as those. The control is before the interview, and was not exposed to violence before, during like a 1 month period, for example, and the treatment is exposure before the interview, pretty much, regardless of whether they were kept on being exposed to violent events after the interview. So, I mean, both types of individuals have some exposure because of the recurrency of violence in Zimbabwe. But just the timing of the date is what makes the difference. So the other thing is that so this is small scale violence, right? And that's something that probably we should also talk more about in the paper. It's not like these massive destructive events, but rather very localized, small scale, and recurrent, especially during the electoral period.
Abby.
Hi, everyone. So, Omar, I was wondering,
if maybe something that could be useful to try to be more specific with your theory would be to conceptualize, spend some time conceptualizing repression versus coercion versus electoral violence, or at least explaining to the reader, if you think that those things are all synonymous, at least in the case of Zimbabwe, why we should believe that, and then doing more work, as you already point out, to explain why the violent events reflect whatever concept it is that you're interested in trying to test the effect of, right? So I was getting confused reading the paper, what you thought repression is, right? And why these violent events constituted repression rather than maybe something else, right? And maybe if it's about electoral violence, then that has, we should expect a specific kind of outcome that may be different from just repression generally. And so this gets back to some other comments about, okay, fine, there's a difference in how people respond to these questions, but I think the real question is for us, what kind of expectations should we have about their behavior, given that they are more likely to respond differently, right, to a question like this? So one change in behavior may be that they're less likely to vote, for example, or more likely to vote for Mugabe, or some set of expectations about behavior down the line, right? So that might help you sort of bring different disparate parts of the paper together a bit better and more concretely. I don't know how you would test any expectations of the behavior, but I think if you try to move away from this idea that people's trust increases and that's the outcome we care about, by thinking about the purpose of the violence, the concept behind it, why your measures indicate the concept well, right, and then some kind of outcome. And just one potential idea, but I'm not sure, I'm not very familiar with Afrobarometer, but I was looking to see what kinds of questions are included, and maybe they aren't included well in Zimbabwe, but whether or not people attended a rally for the opposition previously, whether they voted in the previous election, have you thought about trying to leverage questions like that within the survey to try to disaggregate effects on how people are likely to respond? And that might give you some insight into, again, the effectiveness of this violence, depending on what you anticipate its intention is, right? Yeah. And just generally, a brief general point, it would be great if you could also explain better in the paper why the controls you have chosen are included. So there are really significant effects for, you know, public services, but I'm not sure what that meant, really. So theoretically and empirically, it would be great to have a stronger explanation for that in the paper.
Yeah. Sorry, just on the last point, you mean?
In table 3. Mm-hmm. I didn't see a theoretical explanation for the inclusion of these controls, and I think it's important because it's important anyway, but they're all strongly significant, and I wonder what you think is going on there.
Oh, I see. Oh, yeah, you mean like, yeah, the interpretation of those coefficients.
Exactly.
Yeah, because the inclusion is basically coming from, we are including those for which we find some slight imbalance comparing individuals interviewed before and after the violence. But yeah, that's right. We should have a better justification and interpretation of those. Regarding the point on the behavioral expectations, that's very interesting, and I'll see whether we can exploit on other data sources, or even like from the same Afrobarometer. I think they do have a question on whether they attended like a protest in the past few days or community activities something like that. But I'm not sure we have much on that, but I think that's a very, 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 very good point. We should lay out more clearly our theoretical expectations of the behavioral outcomes.
Okay, myself, Christian, and David. Christian stepped out, but both had two fingers on that. And I want to suggest that you collect the district level voting in the previous election for either ZANU-PF or MDC, whichever, as a way to potentially gain some leverage on the issue of the expectation on you know, the sincerity of preferences, but also because it might provide you with some ability to take a look at, probably in a different paper, a follow-up of some sort, whether or not the, because, you know, we don't think that that this violence is random, and it would be interesting, is, you know, do these sorts of beatings and other events take place in, you know, districts, and, you know, in Bulawayo or in Harare, or, you know, in districts that were, where the opposition is strong, because that would, if that's where that violence tends to get targeted, that would really strengthen the idea that this is primarily preference falsification generation, and that would be a really interesting finding if we find that, wow, that really works. Sending in the hoodlums and beating people up generates support for the president in districts where we wouldn't expect it. That would really strengthen, strengthen the finding. David?
Yeah, just a bunch of quick points to echo. I think it was Abby was saying earlier, you know, there are a number of sort of classic things that are in models of trust in government that don't show up here, that could be here, and she mentioned a number of them. There is information in the Afrobarometer, at least what I know, and looking in particular at the versions of the questionnaire for Zimbabwe, on people's voting behavior. So I think that both whether or not they voted and also party affinities and who they report voting for. So to kind of further Will's point about looking at the sort of electoral and political context. And then I emphasize the point about you know, a number of these variables, not least the one on public services, which are never actually explained in the paper in terms of how they're comprised, how they're derived, and so you kind of have to guess at what they are. I don't know what a value on that variable is, or what the scale is, or, you know, whether one is high or it goes from, you know, 0 to 5 or whatever. So the interpretation of a number of these variables leaves us a bit in the dark.
Just one quick clarification on that. So this is the public services index. It's an index that we constructed using different components, like access to piped water, electricity, and stuff, and just computed a principal components index. We don't explain it. We kind of rush to have a draft. Yeah. But yeah, so it's just that part.
Stephen, and then Christian.
A small comment would be, you'll have to be careful as you use other survey items to as a proxy for these people's preferences. So if you want to go ask them, or you want to look at whether they said, yes, I went to a protest recently, or no, I didn't go, and the mechanism at work is fear and show your mouth, then their responses to those are going to be biased as well. They're like, were you at this protest where there was a riot? And you're like, mm-hmm, it wouldn't be. So those will be more difficult to use.
Yeah. Christian?
Actually, it's Peter.
Yeah, there's the same comment here that, I mean, I like the idea of leveraging more of the Afrobarometer data, but yeah, if those things are also correlated with, I mean, if the story is that the respondents are less likely to report, or like more likely to report thefts, then they also be less likely to report this kind of other behavior. Even the party they're involved in, you know, the support, they're less likely to report truthfully. That could be correlated with whether they see violence. So.
And Omar, the one thing you can do, though, both Christian, you know, Christian was saying earlier, look at previous events. Rather than asking people if they attended a protest, see, have there been protests in that district? Mm-hmm. And similarly, rather than asking people what they voted, see what the use the district level at the in the last one. would be just some things I would throw in. Okay, so the cue's thin. We've got Hanna on a one finger. Omar, did you want to respond to any of that?
No, I'll just now keep getting feedback.
Okay, and Jim hasn't yet jumped in, so I'm going to put you, Jim, next in the queue after Hanna.
Okay.
Okay, hi. I my comments are sort of going back to Stephen's early comment. When I was reading this, I was perhaps less surprised than everyone else at these results because, now I don't know Zimbabwe, so correct me if I'm wrong, but these results are mainly in Shona-heavy districts, and those are the main supporters of the regime. And so what I think would be nice to see in the paper is a greater delineation of the expectations that you have of various groups in society regarding how they're going to react to repression, because people come into these events, whether they're repression or some other violent events, with very different priors, and their priors are going to determine, to a great extent, I think, how they interpret the events. And so if you go and you repress in a Shona-heavy district that's already predisposed to supporting Mugabe, then you're going to get a lot of people that view that repression favorably. And so I would expect them to think that repression is, you know, helpful, increase their trust in government and so forth, because they think that they're sort of observing a regime that they already support coming in and protecting them in some way. So, but that's obviously not going to be true for everyone. And so I would theoretically try to delineate who is going to have the priors that lead them to support the regime when they see repression and who will not. And one thing I worry about, I really like the design. I think it's very clever to look at the, have a comparison group in the same district before the violence took place, and then look at the effects in a group in that same district after the violence took place. But one thing that I worry about is whether districts that experienced repression differ in some fundamental ways from districts that didn't experience repression. So say, for example, that the government is particularly concerned with protecting their supporters, and so they go in and they repress very heavily when anything occurs in Shona-heavy district. And in contrast, they repress less or not at all in districts that are not Shona-heavy. But that's where you would find the people that, if they were subjected to repression, would not report having increased trust in government. But I think that even without looking at those districts, and obviously those districts didn't have repression, so it's sort of the dog that didn't bark, right? But even without looking at those districts, I think that if you delineate very carefully who within the Shona-heavy districts that did experience repression would be the most likely not to view that favorably, even though you would get some responses that would, out of fear, not be truthful. Previous research on election results, at least, suggests that some people are going to answer truthfully or vote truthfully. And so I would expect that for the groups that have a predisposition to view repression negatively, you would get a greater average of those people responding, saying that this did not increase their trust in government. And this comes back to one of Abby's points about the unexplained coefficients on the very large effects of some of the controls. I mean, you don't report the coefficients or the statistical significance of the ethnic fixed effects. I would have liked to see those. I would imagine there might be something there. But also, you know, some of these groups that might be predisposed to viewing repression negatively and reacting negatively to repression might be some of these, might be in some of these controls that you report that are very large, like the public service or, you know, whoever else. I don't know. I don't know the case well enough to tell you what groups I think are going to be the ones that are most interesting, but that's sort of where I would like to see the paper go.
Yes. Oh, should I just comment on that very quickly?
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, I think these points are very interesting. One thing that we will try doing is to explore the heterogeneity of these effects, conditional on different characteristics of the respondents. I think that would be quite interesting to see whether there are some heterogeneous effects and whether they are consistent with the expectations that we could draw based on what we know about Zimbabwe. This is something that we haven't addressed and we should definitely do. The point on which responder are an expectation more likely to answer truthfully, that's quite interesting. And
well, it's not so much about answering truthfully, but which respondents are more likely to think that repression is a good thing. So if you already support the regime, and the regime comes in and represses someone that you think is a hoodlum, then that's going to further increase your trust in the regime. If, however, you think that, you know, that hoodlum has a good point and is engaging in legitimate protest, and you see repression of that person, then you're more likely to view that repression in a negative way, whether or not you truthfully report that.
That's right. Yeah, no, that's a very good point. This is something that, yeah, we could probably address with the exploring the heterogeneous effects of this exposure to repression.
Okay. Jim, and then I have Christian and myself in the one finger. Am I missing anyone? No.
Okay, Jim. So, you know, I don't actually have much to add. I think a lot of the almost everything I was gonna, or my main reactions have been covered pretty well. I guess maybe with some marginal differences. So again, like everybody else, I think it's a great idea for identification. I feel like I've seen it somewhere else, and maybe it's one of the references you gave. But I feel like I've seen it in a political science paper somewhere. That's extremely unhelpful. So we'll just leave that be. But it's a terrific, I mean, it's really, on that score, it's terrific. But as often seems to happen with great identification, is to get you results that are totally uninterpretable. Or at least in this case, it does seem that it's extremely difficult to, we don't really get much insight into actually, you know, what might explain this this pattern. And I guess my main suggestion, you know, as you said, you're having trouble with the framing and presentation. I agree. I really think that, you know, you ought to change the way it's currently presented. In particular, I was really put off by the current setup where you present things as, you know, here are some hypotheses, and then there are kind of short justifications for these hypotheses, which are sort of theory-like or attempts to be theory-like, but they seem extremely ad hoc, and it seems like there's no way that you didn't come up with these after already seeing the results, right? So it just doesn't seem very genuine in that regard, or there's almost no explanation. It's almost like just restating the empirical finding you have. So it's not really an explanation. I liked what you were saying in your comments earlier. One of the things I was going to suggest was maybe a better way to frame it would be, we can't discriminate between whether what's happening is repression is causing people to toe the line, or actually it's leading people who, there's some majority of people who want the government to be repressing, and when they say that we are increasing our trust, what they mean is, you know, we're approving of the policy, we're approving of the repression. We can't discriminate between these two things, but we can say that, either way, you could see why the government would have a reason to do this, like why it pays for the government in a sense. So either you're cowing people, or you're doing what they want, or what some large number of them want. That's one way you might frame it. I think you were suggesting that. Now, on the two psychological, or on these two essentially psychological mechanisms, I guess to me it seemed another reaction I had was that you were putting far more weight on the possibility that, or you know, if I had to guess, I'm much more like a bunch of the other people have suggested, much more on the side that what's happening is that the repression is increasing people's fear and leading them to say whatever they think the government would want them to say. And to me, maybe I'm missing something here, but don't your findings on this freedom of expression and that battery of dependent variables, which is in table what?
Table five.
Table five. Isn't that actually kind of evidence? Isn't that much more consistent with a story that this is about fear? Because I just have a hard time. And maybe I'm sure we could do it. It's we can always come up with some kind of story, but it's hard for me to come up with a plausible story that says that if you repress people, they then say, oh yes, the government. You know, I'm more free to there's greater freedom of expression. That just seems very odd to me, and it seems much more easy to rationalize with saying like, what the repression is doing is making people just be afraid. So this would be, table five. So they get repressed and they say, it reduces their agreement with people are careful talking politics. These just seem very hard to make any sense of psychologically. Maybe I'm missing something there. But that's what made me think that you're putting way too much weight on the possibility that it's actually genuinely increasing support. Next thing, like, what does asking people in Shona or in Ndebele about trust in government mean? Could you ask a Shona speaker to kind of explain, it's even in English, I'm a little unclear what it means when I'm asked, you know, do you trust government? It's kind of a vague thing, right? I maybe a little bit more anthropological sense of is it essentially asking them, do you approve of the government? What exactly does it mean to people? I'd be curious to hear a little bit about that. And finally, a lot of people have raised kind of heterogeneous treatment effects, and you don't really do much with that at all here, and it seems like you could do a lot more. I guess the problem there would be, ideally, you'd like some kind of a theory or some kind of idea about how you could look at a differential response for one group versus another, and that would give us some contribute to discriminating between these two possibilities. But I haven't, I'd also be interested to see, heterogeneous treatment effects by education, by ethnic group, maybe some kind of measures of whether you're likely to be a supporter of the government or not. But on the other hand, I'm thinking like, well, if I saw those results, I'm not sure I would then say, oh, this means, or how they would go in such a way that it would tell me something about, your main problem here, which is the, difficulty of interpreting what the result is.
Yeah, well, thanks very much. Those are very good comments. Seems that we have a lot of work to do. So regarding the heterogeneous treatment effects, I think that's the next step we are heading to. And ideally, we will try to get some district-level measures of polarization, of electoral polarization, and also see whether there are some differential effects based on that.
Oh yeah, could I just jump in there? Yeah, so there's some reference to, in maybe even in the abstract, but in the early part of the paper, to what you're finding is increased polarization, and I didn't see where, how that's justified at all.
Yeah, well, the idea was that there seemed to be like a quite important story about polarization in Zimbabwe along partisan lines, and the way we were reading these results is that the exposure to violence, especially as people approach the election day, tends to polarize more the electorate. So those who trust in the president, trust even more in the president after after the events. Unfortunately, it's...
Well, but you don't have anything on the other side. I mean, and we don't even know if that's true.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So unfortunately, we don't have like much evidence on to support that statement. We thought of that as a possible explanation of our findings. You're totally right. I mean, this is one of those papers in which the identification idea came before the theoretical argument, and it's although I was expecting to find the opposite result, right? Like there is a dramatic decrease in trust.
Exactly, and that's why it's so weird to read you giving an explanation at the beginning. Was like, oh, of course, this we can explain this, like, because if it had come out the other way, it would be really easy to give the a theoretical explanation. But here, I think the kind of we ought to be having explanations like, this is really surprising. What's the deal? And it seems like a first order possibility is one that in the current draft you don't really talk about hardly at all, which is that people are misrepresenting.
That's right.
Christian and David have asked to jump in on Two Fingers. Okay to go to them, Omar?
Oh no, I'll let the Two Fingers.
Okay.
Yeah, my two is merited, so.
Hi, Omar. Really like the paper. I think sort of going off of those previous comments, I think you could really help clarify it by leveraging some of the participation in rebel groups and militia stuff. So I know you sort of cite Weinstein, but there's not really an explanation of how you think that fits into your theory. And a lot of this is both push and pull dynamics that are happening, it seems like, with the civilians or people that potentially might be mobilized to go to protest. On one hand, there's a fear element where they might be driven to the government because of fear. At sometimes they might be pushed away. And I think the literature on participation in rebel groups that Weinstein does, and then the extension to also government-sponsored militias and state security forces, you could use some of that to help sort of buttress your findings and explore these mechanisms a little bit more. Because it's not like, that this is sort of completely new. It's just you're more focused on civilian nonviolent reaction to it, and you could borrow some of the stuff from work on, participation in violent groups, because it has these similar push and pull dynamics.
Mm-hmm.
Can I ask a question? Did you say earlier when you were answering Christian's question that you don't have any information on who's being repressed? Because I'm still having a hard time figuring out why it's so surprising that Jonah supporters of the president are support him more strongly after he represses in their district, assuming that the repression is of someone that they don't approve of, the opposition.
That's correct. So the violence, I forgot to mention that the violence takes place mainly in Harare, which is mainly populated by Shona people. And most of the events are perpetrated against, most of the attacks are perpetrated against the MC. So that's pretty much
the opposition, right?
Yeah, the opposition, that's
okay.
Right.
So the supporters of the president see him repress the opposition, and they have greater trust in him as a consequence. Why is that surprising?
But members of the opposition are also Shona, isn't that correct? Isn't there a distribution?
So the one thing that's interesting is that we find, so we have the ethnic group fixed effects. So we find that the results are held within ethnic groups. So that's why I think it's troubling. Like, regardless of the ethnicity of the respondent, the effect, the treatment effect is the same. We should
dig more into that.
Yeah.
To see.
But can I, sorry, I don't want to jump two fingers.
Yeah, sure, go ahead. David's got a two-finger as well. Can we get David, and then we'll go to Abby, okay?
Yeah, and just to pull together some of the things that Jim was saying a moment ago and some things that Hanna said earlier, I mean, if my first reaction was, do you need polarization here? Now, if you have a more elaborate, structured theory and set of specifications that are about treatment effects and expectations of certain groups, sort of subscribing to the violence because it's in their interest, because it's against another ethnic group that's in the opposition, and so they embrace it, and then other people are cowed by the violence, you might be able to kind of fit those pieces together. Now, if you're not doing a lot of those treatment effects, and if you don't have the theory that kind of really specifically explains those channels, then the polarization makes less sense. And the other thing that I would say that I think comes out of what you were just talking about, kind of where the violent events are located, you know, this paper ultimately is sort of screaming out for some sort of mapping of where is the violence, where are the ethnic groups, where is political support for the government, you know, in the most recent elections. And I think every one of those pieces, between ACLED, between, the data from Lars-Erik Sederman's group, between the data that that many people have, but certainly we have at CLIA on the distribution of votes at a constituency level, all those pieces you can map out, and then the reader would be able to visualize kind of how you're overlaying these different factors that may be driving expectations.
Yeah, no, that absolutely. We have to show this visually as well, like in maps, and to have a better sense of where the violence takes place, what's the ethnic distribution, the spatial distribution of the groups, and the coverage of the Afrobarometer, actually, which is also an important point. So,
right.
Yeah. Abby?
So I was going to go back to something that happened a little while ago now, but to encourage you, when you're reframing the paper, to just acknowledge, I think, as Jim was encouraging you to do, that this was an unanticipated finding, right? That if we expect people to answer honestly, then this is surprising because we wouldn't necessarily expect the goal of repression to lead to increased trust. I mean, but then that requires you maybe you're going to say this, but to be much clearer about what you think repression is, or electoral violence, or what you think is, how you're going to characterize what the government does, or what these violent events look like, and then what you expect the purpose of those, of the repression or the electoral violence or whatever to be, and so how trust or reporting of trust relates to what the violence is intended to cause, right, and what the gap would be there. And I think that could lead to a sort of interesting paper where you then start to, you know, provide some inductive suggestions based on this disaggregation of the empirics that you have, what you think might be going on, right? And ultimately, you know, what is the fact that people are likely to say that they trust the government more lead to, right? And it reminds me of, like, Timur Kuran's work, right, on sparks and prairie fires. Like, preference falsification happens in authoritarian regimes, right? But that doesn't necessarily mean that if there was a given impetus along the way, right, of some kind, that people would be willing to come out and support the opposition. So maybe getting into a broader sense of what the expectation should be down the line in terms of behavior, either voting or supporting the opposition or something. How can we tie that trust indicator to?
Yeah, thanks.
Christian?
I'm kind of with Hanna, but I'm interested in this distinction. The legitimacy of the finding, we'll just bracket for a second, right? But is repression supposed to lead to increased trust, legitimacy, and support for the government? And yeah, that's part of the purpose, right? The government is supposed to prove that it could beat down political opponents. And that's why I was interested in the context, right? I mean, because basically you have government, and you have some repressive agent, and then you have some observer of this repression directed against some target. What we don't know is the relationship between the observer and the target, which is where Hanna was suggesting you look. And then there's like some evaluation of context, right, other than place. So we don't really know what happened previously. We know that the repressive activity is proximate to the individual, but we don't know their relationship to that person. But I would say there is a scenario where you can imagine that trust would be enhanced, and that's like you're taking care of business. You're doing what you said you were going to do. You're taking out people who said that they're willing to take you on and challenge you in some way, shape, or form. And yes, if you kick their ass, excuse me, then yes, you have my increased support and trust. And so I think if you get back at that, then that's very useful.
But how would that square with the at the same time? What at the same time it seems to me, don't you need to explain why it is that observing repression leads people to say, oh no, you don't have to be careful what you say about politics in this country. I mean, yeah. Even if you think that these people are supporters of the president, that's kind of, you know, I mean, I can tell some kind of story that it's just they don't take it literally and they're just trying to say, I support the president, but at a minimum, they're not answering the question on its, you know, at face value, right?
Yeah, I'm caught between, like, that's a combination between, like overt political activity and someone's self-censorship, right? So I'm trying to get the connection between those two things myself, so I'm sharing that one. Anna seemed to be really interested in getting it.
Anna?
Can I just say on that one, if all you're interested in saying is something about the opposition, then it is increasing. If you're afraid that you're going to be a target because you say something about the opposition or the rebels, and the government represses them, then they are increasing your freedom of expression. And if that's all you care about, then that's how you're going to answer that question.
Wait, so you think they're thinking like, oh, because they've repressed the rebels, I can speak more freely in terms of my support for the government?
Or I can just speak more freely about the rebels. I can denounce them or, you know, make whatever I want. Yeah, I think that it's entirely plausible.
So let's just imagine a scenario in Jim Crow South where Bull Connor does what he did, right? And you go out and survey the good white folks of Birmingham afterward. How would they answer these questions? That is that sort of what you're suggesting, Hanna?
Right. It's their freedom of expression. It's not everybody's freedom of expression. It's what they're able to say comfortably without fearing retaliation from the groups that may be oppressed. Or,
but that's not how the question is framed exactly.
No, but if those are the people that are being asked this question, then that would be the response that you get.
Yeah, so we can actually just get to see whether these responses on freedom of expression differ significantly by ethnic group, right? And that would give us a lot of information on whether, you know, it's like a just like purely fear, story of fear, or whether there is actually, you know, whether those who are afraid of the opposition groups are the ones that report higher, you know, levels of freedom of expression.
Would you say the same thing about the third question, like how likely do you think it is that powerful people can find out how you voted? So what happens is that you observe repression and then you actually decrease your expectation, if we interpret it at face value, that repression causes people to think that powerful people are less likely to be able to find out how they voted and so on. Is that because you would say that they're interpreting powerful people as the opposition?
Oh, what I'm saying is that for...
I was speaking to him.
Oh.
I don't know. I'd have to think about that.
Well, she can think about that later. Omar, you were saying something, yes.
Oh, no, I was just saying, like, I mean, it could be the case that if I'm afraid of the opposition and they are repressed, you know, my views on the electoral integrity improve because probably the opposition groups are the ones that are trying to, you know, like alter the electoral returns, or I mean, could be. I need to dig more into the details of the electoral politics in Zimbabwe.
Stephen, two finger.
Yeah, so it's kind of like a one and a half. So we've had an awesome discussion about repression, but looking in the data, like, these didn't strike me as conscious kind of repression events. They were literally things like someone threw a rock and killed someone else, or a nun got beaten up. These weren't like, most of them were not like targeted snatch and grabs of the opposition. So I don't know. They seemed more to me like kind of Bartels-esque shark attacks and random instances.
But that's
of violence.
That's exactly how ZANU-PF uses these guys. They've got this group of war veterans, which it's basically a paramilitary that uses sticks and stones and and they just go around and beat people up. That is what they do. And Mugabe can claim he has no connection to them, but we all know that's false.
I would totally believe that, but I think that it stretches concepts in my mind to think then that citizens are updating about government or parliamentary competence from like thuggery on a Friday night, and that thuggery is loosely targeted in regions of opposition support. But I don't know. I think we're attributing a pretty sophisticated chain to citizens that I would be hesitant about attributing. And like I said, the modal event in this thing was human rights NGO forum formed, which I don't really know what that is or why that's repression.
You haven't been to one of those meetings.
David. That's true, you know.
Yeah, David on a two-finger.
Yeah, just quickly on that, you might actually get some leverage, and I know there are merits to pooling across the waves of the survey data, but just looking at the round four questionnaire from 2009, which I think was one of the three that you used, in that questionnaire, there's a question that's asked about whether the respondent was physically attacked within the last year and how often, and whether or not we know what type of physical attacks those are. You know, some of them may be criminal violence, some might be some other type of violence. It does say physically attacked, which I realize is different from the sort of indirect exposures that you're looking at, but is actually kind of more plausibly a proximate mechanism for people to feel fear than some sort of generalized violence that's sort of out there. So you might get some leverage in probing that particular round, and just looking at the data for Zimbabwe, I think it's over 15% of respondents report having been attacked within the last year, which is among the highest of all the Afrobarometer countries. So it's not that there's substantial underreporting in Zimbabwe. The other question that might be interesting to look at, and again, I don't have access to all the rounds of the questionnaires for Zimbabwe, but round four is up online. There's a question at the end. In fact, I think it's the very last question where respondents are asked, who do you think sent us to do this interview?
Oh, yeah.
Which is an interesting question, the type of question that Christian loves. and it's an open-ended question, but then it's ultimately coded, and it has, you know, state security forces, it has government, et cetera.
Did the man send you?
Exactly. That's not one of the options that they're allowed to code, unfortunately. But again, you might get some leverage on, you know, especially on this angle of the mechanism about people feeling fear. If people are reporting having been attacked in the past, and people are saying, well, I think this survey is coming from the government or the security forces, that's interesting to me.
Omar, you're up.
Yeah, just a quick clarification. We addressed that, and probably we forgot to put it in the draft. But we did look at the question on who is sponsoring this survey, and we didn't find like anything. So basically, so there was not. Most of the people think that it's from the government or the some institution related to the ruling political party, but we didn't find a significant difference between respondents interviewed before and after the violent event.
Christian, yeah, you were actually in the middle of something quite a while back, so you're not even done with your one finger if you want to go back to that. But you're up either way.
No, Jim's riff was a good one. And actually, let me go back to Jim for a second. Back when we were doing like LICEP, the laboratory and comparative processes, there was Jim had expressed a similar type of dissatisfaction that we have with how we write articles, and I strongly agree with that. It takes out some of the actual sequencing of kind of how things are discovered and how things are experienced. And so the fact that you kind of created something and found something and that was surprising to you, but you still have to write this paper, and the way we write papers is if we have this order already in mind, there's something that's kind of not disingenuous about that, but I share the frustration with it and kind of want you to kind of get back at that. But I thought this other issue of, it's kind of like there's something really important about the piece that speaks to how people respond to state coercion, right? And so the human rights movement, we should always be upset, right? But if you read the counterinsurgency literature, you know, there's certain circumstances under which governments are allowed to do all types of violent stuff, and no one should do anything, and no one should say anything. So I think literally that you should kind of, there's a packaging to this that you can kind of address this specifically, because it speaks to this whole issue of how people are evaluating individual instances of state-civilian or state-challenger interactions, and then what that leads them to do in terms of add or detract away from the support for the government or overall legitimacy. And so I think once that's fleshed out, that's very useful, right? So the moral outrage argument, for example, in social movements is very useful, because that's really this instance where someone sees a state action taken against a challenger or a citizen, they're just like, you know what, that's not acceptable. And then they become morally outraged, and that leads to all these micro-mobilization processes, and then next thing you know, people are kind of up in arms against the government. And I think you're kind of speaking to these broader issues, and I think you have an ability to kind of actually at least set that up. And then the difficulties in studying that particular thing, are we able to detect moral outrage in authoritarian context? Are we able to, how are we able to discern that from deference? If you believe the man has come to your door to ask you some questions about like some contentious activities, then play that scenario out. So I'm very pleased at the kind of positioning of the piece in that respect. But then I was kind of like, Op and Rule have a piece there. They kind of talk about mass perceptions of kind of the state-citizen interactions in the context of protests in Berlin. And there's some stuff there that I might I'll send this to you in my comments. But that and the kind of Dallas Micro Foundational stuff, I think there's a bunch of pieces that you're kind of able to situate this around that gets to something very fundamental about how these citizen evaluations of state coercive activity actually lead to all these other things. And so I just really want you to take advantage of that opportunity kind of to tell that story and get there, because I think there's something really important about that, Arab Spring aside, right? But I think there's the broader issues of it. Kind of, I thought about Easton's old work on diffuse and specific support, which kind of really, you have these specific evaluations of state coercive activity, you might think, and then you're trying to link that specific kind of thing to the more diffuse evaluations of the government. And there's something in that translation that's not really laid out with regards to this kind of principal-agent thing about how the things that are happening around you are related to parliament, how they're related to the president, how they're related to the mayor or the police officer. So when you do lay this out, I think that would be kind of useful to lay out that whole process about where citizens sit relative to this whole kind of repressive challenger dynamic, and then think about those evaluations. So more comment than question.
Well, that's a great comment. Just one, can I just ask one quick question?
Yeah, please.
So we also have like a subset of results in which we use a similar strategy, empirical strategy, but for protest, but which are like rather peaceful demonstrations, and which actually yield, we have the opposite findings, right? So more exposure to protest decreases trust in the government. So I just wanted to ask whether you have any sort of comments regarding that finding and the contrast with the violent repression findings. Which, because the issue with that finding is that it's restricted only to the urban areas. So and so we have less coverage in that analysis. But I thought it was still interesting. And initially, we were framing the paper along those lines, like how there are different effects from these different kinds of violence against civilians. I mean, different kinds of political dissent. I just wanted to hear whether you have any comments on that.
My quick
Christian
like
five, innovative. Go ahead,
my quick five finger on that one was like, you know, I'm really excited about that particular finding. That I think that leads in the direction of kind of where I was suggesting it. What I don't like, I mean, you can't really address this in a sense, but what I don't like is the parsing of repression from dissent, right? I'm just like, okay, so when protests took place, there was no cops that were there. I mean, when repression took place, there's no protest involved, and so I think you had it's the joint consideration of the two and how they're relating and responding to one another that's going to lead to these citizen evaluations as being more or less legitimate, right? I mean, so that's kind of those separate results hint at the thing that I'm talking about, but how you get at that kind of dynamism is the thing that I think is the most interesting.
Yeah, just to pick up on Christian's point, I mean, I think you can look at this as there being a whole sort of matrix of events that can be happening within a time window. There can be repression or violence without opposition protest and vice versa, or they could coincide with some particular sequence. They could coincide that they're actually happening simultaneously at the same event. And then looking beyond that, you know, I understand, I assume everybody else understands the utility of trying to isolate this short time frame where the events of violence or protest are proximate and there's less confounding from other factors. But you know, these things are happening against a backdrop that particular localities, particular groups, particular sets of respondents have been exposed to violence in the past, and you have three waves of surveys here. You know, you potentially have the same districts being exposed to violence, you know, leading up to each survey. So I think there's more that could be done about trying to figure out what is the actual nature of the exposure here. And I think you isolate and define exposure potentially too narrowly, and in the process ignore other aspects of exposure that are there. And just one thing before I forget about it, that gets to this aspect of exposure that you don't talk about in the literature review, there's quite a lot of research that's been done in post-conflict contexts with general population surveys and also you know, victim surveys that I've done, looking at people that have been exposed directly and indirectly to violence, meaning indirectly meaning but you know, family members having been exposed, and asking a whole host of questions about political attitudes and behaviors. So there's research on that front kind of getting at this sort of legacy of violence and how it affects or primes or steers people to have particular attitudes about the state, about political actors. So I think you need to be more careful and potentially richer in terms of how you define exposure and how you capture it in the specifications.
Yeah. One thing that we may try at some point, if we is to geocode the interviews for some rounds, that might be possible. And since we have also the exact location of the events, we could exploit the spatial proximity as well to those events. And I think that could you know give us more or enrich our definition of exposure, right? So if you are really, really live very, very close to where the violent event took place, you know, we assume you are more likely to be affected by that event relative to people who live much further away.
I would also, just to add to what Christian and David have been saying, encourage you. It seems to me that you've got a monadic, discrete conceptualization of government repression and protest behavior. And it that can't possibly be the case, at least from everything I've ever read about any cases. It's usually the case that that they go hand in hand. It's rare that there are protests without, although Patrick Regan likes to take issue with this based on a database of his, but many protests at least attract government response. And so while I'm sure there are some monadic events where only one side is acting, I think there's the majority of events, I would think, would be dyadic. And so that's what I encourage you to engage that. That would be one way to get at some of this context that's been discussed in a way that's very manageable, right? So is it, are people beaten up because they were at a protest? Right now, as I understand it, you would be pulling those apart and making them independent. And I think most of us suspect that that the responses might be quite different depending on the conjunction, if you will. So thinking about, dyads of dissident state interaction and not just monads.
No, that's...
And Jim?
Oh, no, it's a one finger, so keep going.
Well, that's fine.
But Omar, did you want to reply on this?
Oh, no, just very quickly. So I think what we are capturing with the protest measure, it's mainly the degree to which opposition groups have higher control of specific territories. So many of these cases of protest that we have are demonstrations where there was not much repression. So it might be the case that we are just, observing, we're looking at some regions of the capital city where the repressive capacity of the state is more limited.
So make that clear, though, and code it explicitly as such, because that would improve our ability to understand, but also the leverage you're able to get.
Yeah.
Jim?
Well, so Omar, you'd asked about the result or the looking at the effects of opposition protests. I thought that was good. And you definitely need to have it in the paper, but it doesn't really help us, or I don't see it as helping on this question of discriminating between the relative importance of repression leading people who approve of the government to increase their trust. It's just the exact opposite. So there's two, just as there were two possible explanations for table three, we've got the same thing here. What I wanted to ask about, though, is on page 17, this manipulation check, which is really good, and it's really good because I guess you see it seems like a really big effect, right? So it suggests that people really are noticing these violent events. But in here, in the first paragraph, you talk about a self the variable is described as a fear of violence in Afrobarometer. And then in the next paragraph, it's described as a fear of repression. Is this a different variable?
Oh, no. Sorry, that was just like a problem with labeling. It's the same variable. It's fear of, of electoral violence or intimidation.
All right, because if you actually had something that was asking them about fear of repression, that would be useful for, like, if they see repression and then they fear it more, but at the same time they're increasing their support for the government, that would really argue in favor of non-genuine responses, preference versus false division. But if it's just fear of violence, I'm not sure how to interpret it.
Yeah, it's fear of violence during, elections or intimidation.
Yeah, political intimidation is part of it. Mm-hmm.
Okay, sorry.
Okay. Well, we are basically at time. Is there anyone who wants to get in a last second comment before didn't get a chance to share it? Hanna?
Something that maybe a separate project, but we've sort of mentioned prior election results. It would be interesting, I think, to look at subsequent election results, because there is some literature that suggests that even though electoral intimidation is effective, it's often not a sure thing. So you do get some measure, maybe, of how truthful responses were in the survey. If you look at subsequent electoral results, if there's very strong support, particularly in the districts where there was repression, or if there wasn't, if there isn't support, then that would suggest that a lot of these responses were fear responses. So I think that might be something interesting to look at.
Yeah, that's very interesting.
All right. Well, thank you all for taking some time out to read through the paper and join us and give Omar feedback. I think we've actually been live during this, and I've actually successfully recorded it. We'll find out when I finish, but that's a first if so. So thank you all.
Thanks very much. It was very, very helpful, especially for the at this stage of the paper, which we are, as you can see, struggling quite a bit with the framing and the interpretation of the results. And I think I got a bunch of ideas that will help a lot to improve the paper.
We'll definitely keep us up to date as to how you do it.
Absolutely.
We'll do it. Thank you, everybody.
Bye. Yeah, good luck, Omar.
All right. Good luck. Take care.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.